all the episodes drop together, this one definitely reads most like a pair meant to be seen together. That said, I'm gonna do something a bit different and tackle these two as one continuous narrative. Summarizing almost feels redundant, and not just because I'm hoping that you all watched these episodes already. Really, it's given that I might as well say Steven continues to prove my assumptions about his arc right. Steven is bound by his self-image as the guy who works things out for his friends, and when they start not only working things out without his input, but moving away from him and off into their own lives, Steven has a hard time with that. This is most obvious with Lars and Sadie. In the original series, they tended to lean on Steven a lot, with their relationship to each other and individual insecurities ironically making the 14-year-old into the adult in the room. Now they've become fully realized people, and their relationship is as good as it's ever been precisely because they've distanced from each other. And yet Steven, ironically given the events of Snow Day, has a very fixed image of them in his head. The secondhand embarrassment that results from that image, for me as a viewer, is also quite strong. These two episodes are the apotheosis of what I mentioned at the very start of the season, regarding how Steven's need to be needed and inability to let go of the status quo clashes with his desperate internal desire to be independent and move away from the past, as well as to the pink tantrums as a symptom of spiraling control issues. As helpfully summarized by Sadie and Shep's song at the end of Graduation, Steven is now in a position where he really does have to look toward the future, and like, his personal internal future. Not just tossing himself into other people's problems because that's how he's defined himself for most of his life. Prickly Pear is Steven's attempt at giving himself a purpose outside of others, even quitting little homeschool, but he's directionless. He doesn't get the same fulfillment from gardening that, say, Lapis and Peridot do. Steven can talk to his plant friends, sentient and otherwise, about what's bothering him in his life, but it's ineffective therapy because he never works around to what he's going to do next for himself. And he still spends the whole time filtering his self-worth through how he affects other people. I've heard fans critical of the show say that sticking to Steven's POV is like a prison of sorts, making it so the viewer doesn't get to see all the relationship and plot developments that Steven himself isn't privy to. The thing is, though, that's life. Steven, like the audience, just isn't ever going to experience parts of life that aren't his own. He is the only person who he will ever spend his whole life with, and neither he nor anyone else is entitled to bear witness to every development of a thing he's invested in when that thing is other people's internal workings. Part of maturing is realizing that as other people are real, you can't always project the things that you want or need them to be feeling in order to suit your mood. And yes, I know that I'm talking about fictional characters, shut up. Sadie and Lars not having gotten together, Lars being largely over it, planning to go back to space, and the suspects breaking up, it's all too much for Steven to process. The future is now, and Steven is the only one who isn't there yet. This includes Garnet, Amethyst, and Pearl, who Steven is projecting a lot onto in the following episode. Prickly Pear reads uniquely for a Steven Universe episode in that it's a legitimate cliffhanger. We're prepping for a patented who-knows-how-long Steven Universe hiatus trademark, but once we're back, we're gonna have to deal with the fallout of Cactus Steven having aired proper Steven's dirty laundry, in the form of self-righteous teenage rebellion against the Gems. It was honestly kind of shocking to hear Steven speak about Garnet, Amethyst, and Pearl with such open contempt, but combined with the events of Little Graduation, it feels like the real issue here is a sense of fear. The loss of control. The Gems, like Lars and Sadie and the cool young adults, are in a position where, well, maybe saying they don't need Steven is pushing it, given they clearly desire to have him in their lives, but they've clearly outgrown the need to have Steven be their primary focus, their living emotional crutch, the center of their world. Steven needs to think of the Gems as having not outgrown the flaws they clearly have. Pearl is still being made of glass emotionally. Garnet is not as wise as she thinks she is, and Amethyst is still on some level immature, because the alternative means that there's no one left for him to work on but himself. It used to be a meme to compare Steven Universe to Steve Rogers, what with the shield and the same name, but it's remarkable how similar their conflicts actually are. Like Captain America in the MCU, Steven has a clear martyr complex and a clear belief that he knows what's best even when he's obviously emotionally compromised. And the lesson he has to learn after all his years of service to other people's needs is to accept when it's okay to take care of himself, to carve out a life beyond the fight, or in this case, beyond the need to literally and figuratively fix everyone. The thing I'm most anticipating going forward is what Connie, Spinel, and/or the Diamond's inevitable roles in future are bound to be. Connie is Steven's partner in crime, at this point perhaps straight-up love interest, and she's been absent for his entire emotional spiral. That feels conspicuous, doesn't it? Part of me feels confident in saying Steven wouldn't be in nearly as bad of an emotional place were Connie with him, but another part of me wonders if Steven is going to be so locked up in his own head by the time she does show up that he risks damaging their relationship, same as what might have happened here in Prickly Pear. Spinel could surely relate to Steven's feeling of being abandoned by those around him, and a world changing around him seemingly beyond all control. The notion of things drifting away even gets a name drop in these episodes. Maybe she could help Steven deal with his feelings the same way he did her? And then there's the diamonds. In just a little bit of collective screen time, we've seen the diamonds transition from the big bads of the show to charming, if still very morally questionable, side characters, more akin to doting old aunts. It's clear from when we last saw them, though, that they have tyrannical impulses which still need to be curbed, usually by Steven. And the notion of them all being put in a room together again with Steven in his current emotional state sounds like a heck of a potential powder keg. As of this episode, White remains the only member of the antagonist screen, barring the big ol' worm, who hasn't featured on feature. Featured on future. And that gets my brain a-tickin'. So far, the only reference we've had across the show to Steven's mom exhibiting the pink tantrums which still plague Steven himself has involved Pink coming into conflict with White. What if this pose from White in the intro isn't a struggle over some kind of mind control like I initially assumed? What if it's just frustration? Frustration that Steven's suddenly become combative and bratty like Pink used to be. What if Steven's positive, controlling influence on the diamond suddenly turns negative? I could theorize all day, but these are all major players in Steven's story and progression as a person, and they're having a role of some kind in what's yet to come is a foregone conclusion. What we've got to wonder coming off this pair of episodes is if Steven is going to remain true to his implied promise of bottling up his feelings even more, and if so, just how much worse things can actually get from here. Oh god, this is getting depressing. Is there another cartoon that I can talk about that isn't so heavy on the angst?
Hey everybody. Thanks a ton for watching the video. Some other things have come up which necessitated this video coming out as late as it did. Namely, Doctor Who's back, baby! And with that show finally being back from its lengthy hiatus, I'm sure Steven Universe fans can relate, it's going to be taking up a lot of my time both on this channel and on my other channel, which is one that is actually co-owned by me and Lucy and Edward. It's a channel where we'll regularly be doing scripted, sort of edited reviews of weekly Doctor Who episodes, much in the same style as I've been doing for Steven Universe Future, whereas this channel is where for the foreseeable future we'll be placing in-depth, spoiler-filled discussions of those episodes. So if you haven't already and you're someone who's interested in Doctor Who, go ahead and subscribe to the channel linked in the description, and check out the episode reviews that are eventually forthcoming toward both that channel and this one. Also, if that last little bit at the end wasn't clear enough, I'm going to be doing episodic reviews of Harley Quinn, the DC Universe animated series. That show is already a good ways into its first season, so what's going to happen is I'm going to do sort of a lightning round video where I tackle all of the episodes that have come out by the time of recording in one video, sort of go episode by episode, and then after that, assuming that I don't take a million years to get that done, and the season isn't already over, then the remaining episodes of Season 1 will be handled weekly, much like Steven Universe Future and Doctor Who. So, a lot on my plate. Here's hoping that I can actually get it done, and that once I do, you all enjoy it. So, thanks for watching.